from the morning, what we have learned through the worship message of how our Lord is everlasting to everlasting, right? Timeless, and he is God. It says, you are God. That means doesn't have a past, or it's not limited by time. So with that thought, let us turn our Bibles to Exodus chapter 33 for today's meditation, please. Exodus chapter 33, verses 14 to 18. Let us all read it together. Exodus chapter 33, verses 14 to 18. And he said, my presence go with thee, and I will give thee rest. And he said unto him, if thou presence go not with me, carry us not up hence. For wherein shall it be known here that I and thy people have found grace in thy sight? Is it not in that thou goest with us? So shall we be separated, I and thy people, from all the people that are upon the face of the earth. And the Lord said unto Moses, I will do this thing also that thou hast spoken, for thou hast found grace in my sight, and I know thee by name. And he said, I beseech thee, show me thy glory. And also, let us turn to 2 Chronicles chapter 5, verses 13 and 14. 2 Chronicles chapter 5, verse 13 and 14 together. It came even to pass, as the trumpeters and singers were as one, to make one sound to be heard in praising and thanking the Lord. And when they lifted up their voice with the trumpets and cymbals and instruments of music, praised the Lord, saying, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. That then the house was filled with a cloud, even the house of the Lord, so that the priests could not stand to minister by reason of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord had filled the house of God. Let us look to the Lord for his grace. Loving Heavenly Father, gracious mighty God, thank you, Lord, for bringing us into thy presence once again, O Lord, giving us a wonderful time of worship, Lord, so that we got an opportunity to open up our mouths and sing you praises and show forth our, bring our offerings as worship. And also, Lord, thank you for giving us a time of remembrance around your table for the bloodshed and the body that was broken for us. Lord, as we delve into your word again, O Lord, this time, give us your grace. Lord, fill me with your spirit. Let not any unwanted thing come out, proceed from my mouth, O Lord. Let only your words be spoken here, O Lord. Let no glory be to me or us. All glory be to the Father, Lord. And everyone who is here, who hears this word, O Lord, let us renew our spirits and be transformed by the wisdom that's that they receive, Lord. Cover me under the shadow of thy grace. We ask in this prayer, in the precious and matchless name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. So today, I would like to talk about understanding the presence and the glory of God. We all know, we've read so many verses in our life. Since the time we held a Bible in our hands, we have read so many verses about the presence of the Lord and the glory of the Lord, right? And let us understand a little more in depth in understanding what it is to come into the presence of the Lord and to be and to seek the glory of the Lord. So this, the presence of the Lord and the glory of the Lord, though they are two profound aspects, in our relationship with God, they are very closely related, but are also distinct in the way that will manifest and impact our lives. So understanding the difference not only will help us experience His presence, but also His glory, and have a more fullness in our relationship with Him. So when we read from Exodus chapter 33, we know the exodus of the people of Israel from the land of Egypt, right? Where Moses was leading the Israelites out of Egypt. And we have read in the morning from the worship that Psalm 90, which was written as a prayer by Moses, where he mentions how feeble our lives are, right? How as a grass withers in the evening, such are our lives. But for God, who is a timeless and everlasting to everlasting God, it is an immense grace that He has shown on our lives, that such a God has come into this world to die for such people who are as feeble or as lowly as a blade of grass. So the presence of God, defining and understanding the presence of God, is God's nearness or His being with His people. It speaks of His relational aspect, where God is among His people, guiding, comforting, and communicating with them, right? That is what we see, where God is communicating with Moses, right? In Exodus chapter 33, if we turn to verse 17. And 18, please.
Moses said, "Please show me your glory."
Yes. So even though the Lord was present with the people of Israel in the form of a cloud in the day and a pillar of fire by night, He was present, right? But we have to delve into why Moses is asking the Lord to show him His glory. That is such a profound statement, that even though Moses himself, being the leader of 6 lakh people, or about 2 million people, right, who came out of the land of Egypt, though he saw the miracles that were performed and God was in with them, that was the relation, a presence of the Lord. But he was asking the Lord to show him His glory. And the presence of God is relational in that way. So we see that in 33 verse 14, it says, God is saying, "My presence shall go with thee, and I will give you rest." So what does His presence give us? It gives us rest. It gives us comfort, right? It is what God is giving us, right? It is nothing from us. We are not just taking in His presence, because God is with us, right? We read in New Testament also, when Jesus was here and when He was leaving, when He was being ascended into heaven, He said, "I will send a helper, the Holy Spirit, to be with you, and He will be with you, helping you, learning the word," right? And if we read Matthew chapter 28 verse 20, it says, "And surely I am with you always, to the very end of age." This is talking about the Lord's presence with His disciples, and affirming that He is near, He's not far, and He will be until the very end. And also in John chapter 1, verse 14, we see that the Word has become flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. It is where Jesus embodied into a human being and dwelt among the world, in this world. And the presence of God was fulfilled and was further experienced through his Holy Spirit, which was promised to his disciples, right? And it was continual. It was not that it would have stopped after Jesus left. Jesus left them with the Holy Spirit. So even when we pray, we ask the Holy Spirit that is in us, whoever is a believer, whoever has accepted Christ as their Savior, we have that assurance that the Spirit of God is within us, teaching us and transforming us, right? And that is the Lord's power and what the Lord's presence is in our lives, right? So if you turn with me to Hebrews 4:16, let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. So here, the Lord is talking about how we can come into his presence, where at his throne of grace, that we can obtain mercy, grace, whenever it's needed. He will give us rest, right? Exodus 33:14 says, his presence shall go with us and give us rest. And in the same way, if we read Psalms 100, verse 4, it instructs us that we enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise, give thanks to him and praise his name. Right? We have to come into his presence with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. That's what we do when we worship. We thank the Lord. We give our thanksgiving. We worship him for who he is, for what he is done to us, right? Now, that is everything that the Lord is doing for us. But here, we have to also remind ourselves that we are coming into his presence, but God is giving us all of that. The Lord, who is eternal, who is timeless, his power is great and his glory forever. And he is giving all of that to us. But what are we, when we come into his presence, what are we giving? Or what are we seeking? That is what we need to remember. That is what the Lord is asking us to. That was what was put on my heart to share with you all today, that we, without just seeking his presence, we also need to seek his glory. And what is the glory of God? How do we seek it? What is the glory of God for us in our lives, right? We look into that. Now, we are focusing on the glory of God. The glory of God refers to the manifestation of God's holiness, his righteousness, his majesty, his power, and his outward expression of God's character. When we come into his presence, are we seeking that? Are we content with just his presence that gives us grace and gives us rest? No, the Lord has asked us, instructed us, that we seek his presence along with his glory, right? In Hebrew, the word for glory is called kavod, and which translates to English meaning weight or heaviness or the strength in some, in a way of saying. So the glory of Lord means the heaviness, the power, the strength of the Lord is his overwhelming presence and the display of his divine attributes. And it is not just his presence of what he can give us, but also refers to who he is, right? The God of glory, who is the creator of the heavens and the earth, right? We read Genesis 1:1, where it says, in the beginning, the God created the heavens and the earth. That's where it started. The time began at that point. But before that, what is? That is God. We have to remember that. That even though we have this wonderful book that the Lord has shown through many scriptures, through many prophets and his disciples, that has been compiled for us, we have to remember that the Lord is not limited by just the time that's in the beginning, which is Genesis 1:1, to the last word or verse written in this Bible. The Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. That is the glory of God. That is the glory that we need to remember. And that is the glory that we need to seek. In Exodus 33:18, God is assuring Moses of his presence. But Moses asks God to see God's glory. That is the thought that Moses had. That is the relation that he has, that God is not just present, but he is not just seeking his presence, but he wanted to see God's glory. That is the zeal that Moses had as a child of God. Though he had millions of people following that he was leading, he didn't take pride in that. But even though the Lord, the living God, was with him, leading the Israelites out of Egypt, that power, he has seen it firsthand, right? He was in the front, in the forefront. He was the first person who was leading. And he saw the presence of the Lord, but he was not content with just his presence. He wanted to seek his glory. That is what the Lord is reminding us, brothers and sisters, today. Are we satisfied with just his presence? Or are we seeking his glory as well? We need to examine ourselves. We read from 2 Corinthians 3:18. It says, but we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. Now, what is the glory of the Lord doing for us? Or when we seek his glory, what is it doing for us? Or why are we seeking God's glory? This passage, right, this verse speaks of the transformative power of God's glory, where we are changed, right? We are not the same. We are not the old person. We are changed into an image, into the same image from glory to glory. Such a great promise that the Lord is saying, that when we behold the glass of the glory of the Lord, we all are changed into the same image from glory to glory. You know, when I read that verse, I felt like literally my hair was standing up. I had goosebumps. The glory of the Lord, the God who created heavens and the earth, he's promising us that glory by the Spirit of the Lord. You know how blessed we are to be even called the children of God. But at times, right, in our busy lives, we seek only his presence. It's not just you all, but it's me personally, where, you know, we come seek his presence when we go, when we are in a hurry, we read our word, we pray, and we only seek his presence, but we don't delve into his glory. What are we doing? Are we a child of God? Are we being transformed into his image from glory to glory? We have to examine ourselves. If we read from Hebrews chapter 12, verse 28 to 29. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 28 to 29. Wherefore, we, receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved, let us have grace, whereby we may serve God acceptably with the reverence and godly fear, for our God is a consuming fire. Who is our God? A consuming fire. That's an attribute of the glory of the Lord. He is a consuming fire. And verse 30 also, please. So we see that the Lord is a consuming fire. And how are we to serve God? With reverence, right? When we come into his presence, when we come around the table that is set before us, we come with reverence, right? I always remember Janana saying, this is a solemn time. Come to the table with reverence and with fear. And I always remember that word. He never forgets to say that. How many of us come into the presence of the Lord and to seek his glory around the table with reverence and godly fear? We examine ourselves, yes, in the light of the word, but are we beholding his glory that we seek? Are we seeking it daily? And these verses emphasize that the Lord's unbreakable bond of his presence with his people, and assuring that his presence is not just there, but it's constant and it's not it's unfailing. You know, when we read from Exodus all the way to the verse Hebrews 12:29, it says he's a consuming fire. That same fire, that consuming fire that was there when the Israelites were led out of the promise, out of the land of Egypt, and he was in that pillar of fire, right? And if we go back to the passage that we read initially, 2 Chronicles chapter 5, verse 13 to 14. It says, just the 14th verse, please.
So that the priest could not stand to minister because of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord filled the house of God.
The priests, the ordained priests of the Lord, they could not stand when they came into the tabernacle of the Lord. They couldn't stand the glory of the Lord, but he has given us a transformative power to be changed into his glory. To glory. That is the glory of the Lord that filled the house of God that we read. That's the power of the Lord that he has given us. And he's asking us, he's reminding us, we seek that daily in our lives. When we enter into his presence every day, we do read our Bibles. We meditate on the word of the Lord. How do we do that? It says in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 16. It says, let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. We have to come boldly. Are we able to come boldly? The priests could not come boldly, because they couldn't face the glory of God. But here it is saying the exact contrast, right? He's saying, come boldly unto the throne of grace to seek his glory, to into his presence, that we can obtain mercy and grace. When do we get that? In time of need. When do we need it? We need it every day to sustain ourselves. Our spiritual lives are sustained by his presence and his glory alone, his righteousness, his holiness, his unchanging love, his magnificence, his power. These are all his glory. But do we have that time that we seek the glory of the Lord? We have to come to the presence of the Lord and seek his glory with a heart of worship and humility. We read from Psalms 100 verse 4, right? We enter his gates with thanksgiving in our hearts. We sing that song too. Enter his gates with thanksgiving in our heart. Enter his courts with praise. Do we do that? We have to examine ourselves. And remember that seeking God's presence and glory go hand in hand. And there are certain drawbacks to only seeking God's presence. Yes, if we are only being content with experiencing the presence of God without seeking his glory, the presence of God provides comfort and guidance. But it is possible to become complacent in our spiritual lives because we are not seeking the transformative power of his glory. The Israelites, right? Now, comparative to Moses and the Israelites, we know that the Israelites always complained. They murmured against the Lord. They said, oh, it would have been fine if we stayed in the land of Egypt, where we had good food to eat. But here in the wilderness, we don't have anything. That's when the Lord provided manna and the quails to feed them. But they were not satisfied yet. They kept murmuring. But in all of this, Moses was a patient man. He sought the presence of the Lord along with his glory. He was, if we read after in the chapter 33, in the later verses, we see that Moses wanted to see the Lord. But God said, you cannot behold, you cannot see me in my full glory. And he said, the Lord said, I will cover you with my hand and you can see the back of me because you won't live if you see me face to face. Such was the great glory. But Moses insisted. And you know, when Moses insisted that, God was gracious. He allowed Moses to see his glory. And what were the Israelites doing at that time? They were going against the Lord. When Moses was up there, when he was communicating with the Lord, when he was seeking his glory, they were impatient. They could not wait for the instructions that were coming back from Moses. And they sinned along with Aaron and the others. They made the golden calves and started worshiping them. How sad that is, that they've seen all the miracles of the Lord and all the great things that the Lord had done and while bringing them out of the land of Egypt. We see that they remembered, but they, because they only sought his presence. They did not seek his glory. Such a sad thing, right? And out of the more than a million people who came out of Egypt, there were only two people who entered the promised land. So many of us will seek the Lord in his presence. And on that day, the Lord said, you know, there will be many who come and will say, Lord, Lord. And I will say to them, I do not know thee. You know how sad that is if the Lord is saying that about us. Because they will say, oh Lord, we perform miracles in your name. Yet the Lord says, your heart was not with me. So I do not know you. So When they sought the presence of the Lord, they didn't seek the glory of the Lord. They were satisfied with his power that came with his presence, but they did not seek him fully. They did not have that relationship with him. And why is it necessary for us to seek God's glory? It helps us to maintain a posture of humility, reverence towards him. When we come into his presence, right, we cannot come lightly. We don't take it because we can just walk in, right? We park our cars and we come into the house of the Lord. We come into his presence, right? But when we seek his glory, our hearts have to be humble. There's nothing, there's no good in us, right? There's so much pride in our lives, you know, that keeps us from being humble. What do we have? We read in Psalm 90 in the morning, we are reminded from the word of the Lord that we are as grass in the morning that withers in the night, right? Who are we? We are nothing. We are in the morning it flourisheth and groweth up, in the evening it is cut down and withereth. Such is our lives. They're here, there one day and gone tomorrow. We do not know what the future holds for us. Do we know for a certainty that we all will be alive tomorrow? Do we know that? Nobody knows that except the Lord. And only through his grace and his mercy are we able to survive, because he has given us that life. We have to remember that. And that is why we have to seek his glory. And he's also holy and powerful. And he deserves that utmost respect and worship. The highest form of worship, the highest form of reverence we should show him. So many of us, some of us are working and some of us go to colleges and schools, and many of us have been under the people of authority, right? Our bosses, our professors. We all listen to them, right? We respect them. We listen to what their instruction is, right, for our lives. So if our boss says, oh, do this work, I need it by tomorrow, we make sure we do it, right? When a mere human is instructing us to do a certain task and we do it without asking questions and we do it to our best, right? Why? Because we want our boss to like us so that he would not give us more trouble, correct? And because you have been hired to do a job, and our boss looks at us, or our professors, when they give us assignments, they expect us, our teachers who give us assignments or homework, they expect us to learn from that. But they also need to know that they are at a place of authoritative and authority, and they are the ones governing or instructing us. And we show so much respect and we listen to whatever they say. But the great God, the creators of the heaven and the earth, when he instructs us, this book is not just any book, right? We just don't carry it lightly. This is the word of God. The creator of the heavens and the earth has given us his personal instructions through this book. How are we looking at it? We need to examine ourselves. Such a, in this world, when I was a youngster, I used to be very careless in a way that I did not take anything serious. And it became a kind of a hindrance for me to come into his presence and seek his glory. Because when I don't respect or give my reverence with my whole heart to the word of the Lord or to his presence or to his glory, I do not grow. The transformative power of the Lord does not work in my lives. Correct? And how do we balance that presence and the glory of God? Perfect example for that is Moses. He not only sought God's presence, but his glory as well. And we know David, when we read his Psalms, he acknowledges that, Lord, that he is limited by his human abilities, right? Though God has given him an anointing, he has been anointed as a king, but he always prayed that he wanted to be found in the presence of the Lord. And he delighted himself in the word of the Lord. And he was called a man after God's own heart. And it's not people who or people around him who has given that reference to him. God himself has said, David is a man after my own heart. That is how much the Lord loved David, but also David loved God. And when you love and seek him, even though he did not take pride in that, he constantly sought his presence and his glory. And most of the Psalms that we read, right, it talks about how he's praising the Lord and he's worshiping the Lord in all his glory and all his holiness. And by that, we have to understand that how much of a heart of seeking God's glory that David had. How many of us are here that seek that in the same way? I'm not saying we need to be like David, but at least we have to try to be like him. Yes, David had his own faults and he fell into sin, but he got back up and he went back to the Lord, right? In the same way, we have a good example of a person who was in the presence of the Lord, but he did not seek his glory. We all know one of the disciples of the Lord Jesus, right? Judas. He betrayed the Lord, even though he saw that the Lord was great. He was with him, right? Through day and night, he was in the Lord's presence. But he did not understand or he did not give his reverence to the glory of the Lord. And even though he betrayed the Lord, maybe, I don't know, if Judas would have asked for forgiveness and came back to the Lord by the cross, maybe Lord would have definitely forgiven him, but he did not. Out of his guilt and shame, he went and he gave up his life. And we can learn a lot from that we seek the Lord in many of our difficult times, but when we are happy and when we are content, are we still seeking him? Are we still seeking the Lord? The Lord did not change. We are changing. We as humans, yes, we have limitations, but we are changing. We are not taking the Lord as he is. We are not glorifying the Lord in our lives. And how can we cultivate this reverence for the Lord's presence and the Lord's glory? We have to seek him daily through prayer, worship, and reading the word. You have to ask the Lord in every aspect of our day, every aspect of our life, in our relationships, in our decisions. When we give him first preference, the Lord will show his glory to us. Let us turn to Psalms 46:10. Let us read from Psalms 46:10. It says, "Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth." Here the Lord is saying, He is exalted among the heathen. He will be exalted in the earth. And the Lord comes back in all his glory when the trumpets sound, when his coming is near. We all know with all that's going around in this world, we know that his coming is near. We are instructed day in and day out. We hear, we listen to so many sermons, and yet our heart is away from him. We need to examine ourselves. We need to ask for his transformative power in our lives. And in the same way, I wanted to conclude that the presence of God rightly influences us in our lives. In Matthew 28:20, it says, "He is with us to the very end of age." Right? Even unto the end of the world. Amen. "I'm with you always." He's with us. He's not leaving. He's not taking away his presence from us, but just seeking his presence. Are we content? The glory of the Lord, on the other hand, transforms us to behold his majesty and holiness. In 2 Corinthians 3:18, Paul writes that we contemplate the Lord's glory, right? Beholding in a glass of the glory of the Lord. That means that God's glory shapes our characters and our actions. Once we stop just relying on his presence and seek his glory, that will reflect in our lives, in our spiritual lives. And that way, God will lead us to do mighty things. And the presence of God and the glory of God are two dimensions of the same God. Remember that. And there is a difference, in a way, between seeking his presence and glory. But we are seeking his presence and his glory for the same God. We are not seeking a presence of the Lord from... we are seeking the same God that has created the heavens and the earth, and the same God that died on that cruel cross of Calvary and rose up on the third day. The one who got beaten. His blood was shed for our sins. Yet, the same God has given us a helper, the Holy Spirit, to be with us, transforming us. But are we limited to his presence and not his glory? I read this from a missionary's message that I wanted to read to you in conclusion. That if you only visit his presence and view what he can do for you rather than who he is in his glory, you do not have a gospel. What you have is a hobby. If you can leave his presence unchanged, you're not a tabernacle of the Lord, of his glory. You are a slave to your flesh and desires. You have a hobby because if you think you can just pick up and put down, become interested and uninterested at your convenience, and if you can be around things of God and not be changed by the glory of God, you do not have the good news. You have a form of hobby. Do you wonder why you are stuck in a cycle from event to event and feel like you're waiting for certain events or church services or some messages or sermons to breathe life into you. It's because you have become addicted to temporary trips into his presence instead of being hungry to live in his glory. Through his presence, we are blessed, but by his glory, we are transformed. And we are drawn to closer to him. Today, as I conclude, I wanted to let you all know, examine, and know that his presence can give us the rest that we need, but his glory can give us the transformation of our lives, a renewed spirit in our lives, that the Lord is, the Lord will be happy. And his presence assures us of his constant companionship and guidance, and his glory reveals his majesty and power. And through these few words and through these few thoughts, may the Lord be glorified, and may we seek his presence and his glory in all that we do.